Thank you, Nancy. Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Butteville Community Church. It is so good to be with you this morning. If you're new with us, I would encourage you to grab a bulletin, grab a connection card, fill out one of those connection cards, drop it in one of our offering boxes so that we can connect with you and welcome you to our church and get you more information about what we're doing in our church. I just want to draw a quick attention to our bulletins for some brief announcements. First of all, Michael, if you'd put a couple slides up. These slides were running earlier as you walked in. I want to give a big thank you to everyone who helped us with our five-day club. We had volunteers come, and they worked and served and helped for 5 days, Monday through Friday this week. And we had the gospel proclaimed. There's Roger's horse. The kids got some horse rides around our yard. And I can personally share with you that there was spiritual fruit from the gospel being proclaimed in these kids' lives. So a big thank you to all of you who helped with our five-day club. I'm also instructed to tell you that there's a card-making party that the ladies are putting on. I really wanted to go, but apparently it's just a ladies' thing. Anyway, there's a sign-up if you are, in fact, a lady. There's a sign-up in the back in the foyer if you want to be a part of that card-making party. And then I would just invite your attention to our prayer meetings on Wednesday night at 6. It's a great time to get together to pray together as a church. In September, you know, the summer is done and fall is upon us, and we have fall activities coming up, as is indicated in your bulletin. And there's a church worship night that I would encourage you to come to. Roger is going to put on a worship night for us, and we're going to sing songs and praise the Lord together. So I'd encourage you to come to that worship night. And did you say that was at 6 p.m., Roger? 6 p.m. on the 23rd. Also, we're putting on a concert in October. It's something to be thinking about and praying for. We're hoping to reach out to our community and outreach to them through this concert. So it's not just a fun concert, but it's also a concert with purpose. And I'd encourage you to spread the word and bring people who would be benefited by that concert, bring people who need to know the Lord and would be encouraged by our fellowship together. Well, it is good to be in the house of the Lord with you. I want to begin with a call of worship, and I'd like to invite Tim up here to read our call to worship for us.
Thank you. I'm going to read Psalms 98. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous deeds. His right hand and his holy arm have accomplished deliverance. The Lord has made known his salvation. His righteousness he has revealed in the sight of the nations. He has remembered his mercy and his faithfulness towards the house of Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the deliverance of our God. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all the earth. Break out in loud songs and sing praises. Sing unto the Lord with the harp and the sound of melody, with trumpets and the sound of the horn. Make a joyful noise before the Lord, the King. Let the seas roar and all that fills it, the world and those who live in it. Let the rivers clap their hands, let the hills be joyful together before the Lord. For he is coming to judge the earth. With righteousness he will judge the world and the people with justice. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you, Lord, for this time that we can gather together and we can listen to your word. I ask that you bless Pastor Jacob as he preaches and that he may open hearts, Lord. And if there's anyone here that doesn't know you as their own personal Savior, I would pray this day they would seek out Pastor Jacob and talk to him about their internal salvation and where they would like to spend eternity, with you or without you. For it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
I encourage everybody to stand up and make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Here we go, key of F. 1, 2, 3. Keep playing that, and you guys go like this.
Children to go to Children's Church, and we'll pray for them. So anybody who wants to go to Children's Church, here we go. Now's the time. Adventure and stories and learning awaits. five. Bam. Let's pray. Lord, we pray that you would open our eyes that we may know you and see you from your word. We pray for our children that they would know you. We pray for ourselves. Lord, open our eyes through our time of worship. Help us to know who you are and reveal yourself to us that we may respond and believe in you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Never heard that song before. Interesting. That was 800 years old, that song. It still has good lyrics, doesn't it?
Sing with me, how great is our God. beginning and the end, the beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb.
How great is our God!
Above all names,
name above all names, worthy of all praise. The harp will sing, how great is our God.
How great is our
our God, and all will see how great is our God.
Lord, thank you for being a great God. Thank you for looking after us. Thank you for all that. We're going to get some good message from Pastor Jacob. Thank you for the visitors today. We give you all the praise. Amen.
Good morning. As we continue our time of corporate worship, as we come before the Word, let us pray again. Father, thank you for bringing us here today. Thank you for the goodness that you give. Truly, you are great, and there is no other God besides you. Your name is greatly to be praised, and we thank you for all the good things that you have given us, that you are a high king, exalted and lifted up, that the victory comes through you. We pray that you would be our vision this morning as we come before you. Father, you know the weeks that each of us have had. You know our anxieties, our troubles, our struggles this week. I pray that you would calm our hearts, comfort us with your love, and give us the food that we need this morning. Savior, like a shepherd, lead us, and we will listen. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I don't know if any of you can remember a time in your life, I know many of you are slightly older than me, when you've gone shopping with children. I don't know if that gives you any kind of trepidation or flashbacks of bad memories, but shopping with children is a joy that I occasionally get to partake in when my wife decides, hey honey, why don't you take the kids to Walmart and go get some groceries for us? I'm like, sure, I'll do that. So I take my children, and I love my children, but we go shopping. And as you may already know where this is going, sometimes that is a nightmare, right? The kids are always wanting to see and explore and touch, and you have to say, nope, don't touch that, nope, don't touch that, nope. In fact, why don't you just hold on to the cart? Just touch the cart all times, both hands, like don't do anything. And it's a joy to take our kids shopping with us. You know, when I take them shopping, I will try to engage them with what I'm doing, and they just love to reach up a hand and to push the cart with me. And they say, Daddy, Daddy, can I push the cart? And I'm stuck, right? What do I say? Well, here's the deal. No, you can't push the cart, because I just can envision where them pushing the cart is going to go, right? My son Bezalel, I'm pushing the cart into the cans of green beans, and it all comes down onto the floor. So what I do is I say, okay, well, Daddy's going to push the cart, and if you want to join Daddy, you can put a hand up onto the handle, and you can push with me. And he says, but Daddy, I want to push all by myself. And I'm like, no, Daddy will push, and you can push with me, and we'll push it together. And as I think about the fun of pushing with my children, I also think about the difficulty and the power of prayer. As we look at our text this morning, we're going to see a passage on prayer, how Paul prays for the Ephesians. And as we think about prayer, I know there's a lot of difficult questions that can come up. As we meet here on Wednesday nights and pray, I tell people, you know, prayer is hard work. And here we are, and we're going to roll up our sleeves and focus for this hour, and we're going to pray, because apart from our Father, we can do nothing. And I know I've talked with some of you, and we've asked hard questions about prayer. And why, if God knows exactly what I'm going to ask, and if God is all-powerful and he's going to do what he's going to do anyway, why should I pray? I could think of similar questions that my son would ask me. If what's the point of me pushing if Dad's hand on the cart is stronger than mine and he's going to steer the cart wherever he wants to, but he's inviting me to push with him on the cart? Prayer is important. And in the ministry of prayer, we have the ability to join with our Father in the work that he's doing and to allow him to work through us. We'll see in our text today why we must pray. Without God's work in our lives, we remain unable to accomplish anything. Dead in our sins, blind, ignorant to knowledge, without hope or purpose or power. As we turn to Ephesians chapter 1, verse 15, let's stand for the reading of God's word. The word of the Lord comes to us today from Ephesians 1:15. For this reason, because I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, I do not cease to give thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him, having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his great might that he worked in Christ, when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the one to come. And he put all things under his feet and gave him as head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. Amen. You may be seated. Again, as we come to our text, we want to look at it in its context. Last week, we began our journey in Ephesians, and we saw that Paul writes from prison to this church in Ephesus on the western coast of Turkey, how he spent 3 years there ministering and serving the church, teaching in the lectures hall and building tents, making tents for himself. We remember the painful departure he had with the Ephesian elders when he went to Jerusalem saying, I'm going to be bound, and how he exhorted them to guard the doctrine of the church, that wolves are going to come in, but keep the deposit pure and shepherd the flock of Christ. And Paul now goes to Jerusalem, and he goes to Rome, and he's imprisoned for the sake of Christ, but he cares about these people, this church in Ephesus, and about their love for the Lord. And he writes to them, and he praises God for the amazing salvation that God has given them. He praises God for what the Father has done in choosing them to be his own. In love, he predestined us for adoption as sons. He praises God for the work of the Son, Jesus Christ, and how he has redeemed us through his blood. How Jesus is the revelation of God the Father to us, that we may know God the Father through Jesus the Son. He has made known the Father and made known his will. That is, God is working all things to the praise of his glory. Jesus has also given us an inheritance, that we have a future and a hope, an inheritance laid in heaven for us that cannot be taken away. And through the Spirit, we have been sealed for this inheritance and given a guarantee of it until we get there to the praise of his glory. We saw that we should also be thankful for our salvation, and we should also align our lives to be to the praise of his glory and not to our own. As we come now to our text in verse 15, Paul transitions and he talks directly to the Ephesians. And as he talks directly to them, he offers up this prayer for them with thanksgiving for what God has done for them and with petitions of what he asks of them, of the Lord, for them in prayer. Paul's prayer for them reveals to us how important the working of God is in our lives and how important prayer is in that process. We simply must pray for God's work in our lives and in the lives of others. Specifically, we'll see this morning that we must pray for knowledge, we must pray for hope, and we must pray for God's power at work within us. So, verse 15, as Paul transitions, he says, for this reason. For what reason? For the reason that God has worked this marvelous salvation for the Ephesians. And because I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love toward all the saints, Paul says to them, I do not cease to give thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers. Paul prayed, and this may sound like an understatement, but we should be people of prayer too. I know that prayer is difficult, and that prayer is sometimes one of the last things that we do at the end of our day when we come to bed and we try to pray. And if you're anything like me, you might start off with some good intentions. Start off with, Dear Jesus, thank you for what you've given me today. Please help me for this and that. And you fall asleep. It's hard to endure in prayer and to stay focused. I don't know any length that I try to focus and close my eyes. And if I'm any measure of tired, I'm going to fall asleep quickly. It's hard to focus, it's hard to pray, but prayer is work, and it's good work that is necessary. Paul prays for these people. He has done a lot of work for them. He has spent 3 years among them. He has trained them. He has exhorted them. He's charged them. And now, as he sits in prison in Rome, he can't do much for them other than write this letter and pray. And his prayers he gives ceaselessly. He says, I do not cease to give thanks to God for you, remembering you in my prayers. Any good disciple maker who calls people to follow after Jesus is going to be a prayer warrior. Because anyone who tries to obey the great commission that we have been given to make disciples of all nations is going to quickly realize that we lack that kind of power, right? It is not within me to go and make disciples of all nations in and of myself. Jesus says, apart from me, you can do nothing. So if I set out in faith to go about the work that Jesus has called me to do, to share my faith, to preach the gospel, to bring people to Christ in belief and repentance, and to equip them with everything good so that they may be mature and rooted in Christ and able to repeat the process with someone else, I need God's help, right? I need God to be at work in me, in my words, to work through my foibles, my blunders. I need God to be at work in them, to open their ears, to give them eyes to see, a willingness to obey and to change their lives. Any good disciple maker is going to care for his people and pray for them that God would work in their lives, because any good disciple maker knows that it's ultimately Jesus who is the true disciple maker and shepherd. Paul specifically prays for the Ephesians, and he brings specific things to God in his requests, and we should too. Our first point is that Paul prays for their knowledge, and we should be praying for our knowledge and for the knowledge of others. Verse 16, I do not cease to give thanks for you, remembering you in my prayers. What exactly is he praying for in his prayers? Well, verse 17, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him. Maybe this may come as a surprise to you, but knowledge of who God is a gift. It is something that God gives to us. You were, as we'll see next week, dead in your trespasses and sins in which you once walked, but God made you alive, gave you eyes to see, gave you a heart that beats, gave you knowledge of him. And without the knowledge of God, we cannot come to him. Jesus says in John, no one comes to me unless the Father who sent me draws him. And one of the ways that God draws us to him is by giving us knowledge of who he is. One way or another, each of you are sitting in these seats. God has brought you here. God has given you the opportunity to know him, to know his word. After today, when you walk out of these doors, you cannot depart saying that you have no knowledge of God's work in the Ephesians, or hopefully no knowledge of what God wants to work through you, because you have heard his word. As I remember a movie I once watched of the Pilgrim's Progress, it was said, as this message comes and finds Pilgrim Christian, that one does not simply find the book finds you. And as God reveals his knowledge to us, we come to know him because of his gracious action. The truth is, without knowledge, we're blind, like blind people. We don't know what is truth, we don't know what is right. We don't know what is wrong, and we, like blind people, stumble around, fumbling and putting our hands out there, trying to discern what is and what is not. And it's only through the knowledge that God gives that we have wisdom and sight. I've discovered this myself, that knowledge brings wisdom and sight. I don't know, for those of you who have grown up in Oregon or those of you who have moved into Oregon, I remember distinctly the days when I first moved down to Oregon, and I was a freshman in college. I was going to college down in Salem, and I pulled up to a gas station. And I got out of my car, and I attempted to pump gas. And I hope you know where this is going. I received some counsel. That's a nice way to put it. I received some sharp rebukes from the man who said, "What are you doing?" And I said, "I'm pumping my gas." And he says, "You can't do that here. I'm going to pump your gas." I'm like, "Last time I checked, this is America. Can I not pump my own gas?" And you know how the saying goes. I learned that in Oregon, you don't pump your own gas. You let the nice man there pump your gas, and you tell him what you want, and you sit in your car, and you take a nice quiet moment to breathe. But without knowledge, I am a blind man fumbling around with the pump, and I'm quickly corrected with what is and what is not. Incidentally, I recently went down to the Flying J Travel Center, and without knowledge that apparently there's no workers who pump your gas at the Flying J Travel Center, I sat in my car and waited for a few minutes. And I exchanged weird looks with the men from their cars as they got out of their cars and started pumping their own gas. And I looked at them like, what are you doing? And they looked at me sitting in my car and they're like, what are you doing? Knowledge brings sight. And without knowledge of what is truth, we're blind and we're helpless in our blindness. We stumble about in our blindness and we end up doing silly things. We must pray for knowledge. Without a knowledge of who God is, we are not able to access Him, to know Him, to approach Him, or to approach life. Because the person of God gives us the truth by which we see all of life. The psalmist says, in your light do we see light. So we must pray for our knowledge. We need to pray for knowledge, first and foremost, for ourselves. God, help me to see you, to know you. As I read your word, God, help me to understand it. Because the Spirit will give us wisdom and knowledge of who God is through His Word. But if we're not asking Him to give us knowledge, we're going to stumble around and probably mess things up. We need to ask for knowledge for other people, for those who are lost, because they have no knowledge of how to come to salvation. And we should pray, we should plead with the Lord. Lord, reveal yourself to them. Because I can sit here and I can tell you the gospel all day long. I can give you the words of life. But apart from the Spirit of life working within your heart, quickening your heart from death to life, my words are going to go over your head. We ought to be praying for knowledge of God for each other. That we as a church, as brothers and sisters in Christ, may be built up in love. That we may know Him, to come to the fullness of knowledge of Jesus together, and that we may have fellowship in our knowledge of Jesus. Well, Paul prays for their knowledge, and knowledge is important. But knowledge by itself is also not good. Paul also prays, secondly, for their hope, for their knowledge of the hope. He says, having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, verse 18, that you may know what is the hope to which He has called you, what are the riches of His glorious inheritance in the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of His power toward us who believe. In Paul's prayer that the Ephesians may have knowledge of God, that the Spirit of God would give them wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of who God is, he specifically prays in their enlightenment that they may know what? Well, he gives them three what's. That you may know the hope to which He has called you, the riches of His glorious inheritance in the saints, and the immeasurable greatness of His power toward us who believe. If you take those three things that he prays for and you add them together, you get hope. Knowledge without hope, maybe accurate knowledge. The demons have knowledge. Satan has accurate knowledge of who God is. But hope is something entirely different. We are able to know that God has called us not to fear, not to doubt, but to hope. He has called you to hope. He has given you riches in a glorious inheritance that cannot be taken away from you, that you are sealed in this inheritance. And He has given you a knowledge of immeasurable power that God works on your behalf. And when we are convinced of the hope that God has given us, that He is powerful, that He is working for our good, that He has a home in heaven for us, that where I am, Jesus says, I will come and bring you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. We know the hope that God has called us to, and that hope gives power and life to our knowledge. Again, I mentioned the Pilgrim's Progress earlier. If you're familiar at all with the Pilgrim's Progress, you know that pilgrim Christian goes on a journey. He goes on a journey to find the celestial city because he realizes he lives in the city of destruction, and he needs to flee from that city to go to the celestial city where the king bids him come. And so with some promptings and pushes from evangelists and several other friends in his life, Christian embarks on this journey. But it's a journey not without peril. In fact, he frequently falls into peril, and he picks himself back up and he continues on the journey. One of my favorite scenes from Pilgrim's Progress is the peril that Christian faces from the giant despair. Pilgrim and his friend Hopeful are minding their own business, journeying along the way, and they get tired and they fall asleep in a field. And they don't know that this field happens to belong to the giant despair. And the giant despair finds them sleeping in his field and takes them as vagrant vagabonds and brings them to his castle, beating them along the way, and he puts them in the dungeon. And they spend from Wednesday night to Saturday night in the dungeon of despair. And they struggle. They struggle to keep their faith. They struggle to know what to do. They're imprisoned on Wednesday night. On Thursday night, the giant despair comes down and beats them mercilessly until they are bruised and lashed and have open wounds. And then he leaves them there. On Friday night, the giant despair comes down and berates them with his words to make them feel worthless, like nothing. And then the giant despair tells them that they should kill themselves, that there's no hope in life, and here's a couple methods for you to kill yourselves, and you're locked up in this cage, just end it. And he leaves. And they talk, Christian and Hopeful, they talk amongst themselves about whether they should. And they come to the conclusion that there is hope, that they should trust that the Lord is working, that he will deliver them. On Friday night, the giant despair comes back and he shows them, he brings them out of their cage, and he shows them the bones of everyone that he has imprisoned before them. And he says, 10 days hence, I'm going to rip your limbs and your legs apart and you're going to be just like these bones. So you might as well end it now. And they go back, and Bunyan writes, and he says, they prayed Saturday night. They prayed from midnight till the morning. And then in the early morning hours, Christian, feeling like a fool, cries out, "Alas, what a fool am I, for I have here in my bosom a key called promise, which I am persuaded will unlock any lock in Doubting Castle." And it always makes me laugh because Hopeful responds in kind of an understatement kind of way, but as Bunyan writes in his slightly old English, he says, "What good news! Good brother, pray, pluck out the key from your bosom and try." And I remember this story of how Pilgrim has this key called promise that is in his bosom the whole time, but he forgets about it. He doesn't remember the hope that is given to him. And when he pulls out the promise and when he tries it in the lock, every lock opens before him. The cage, the dungeon door, the outer gates, till they leave the castle and they leave the giant's jurisdiction and he cannot follow them and he cannot claim them. And sometimes we're just like that. We know the promises that God has given us, but we forget about them. And without hope, our knowledge can be a shackling prison. We need knowledge and hope for Christians to grow in their faith and to be rooted and mature in Christ. We ought to pray, "God, give me hope to get through the struggles that I'm facing." I know each and every one of you has different challenges in life and different struggles that you're facing in life. And sometimes we can face those struggles and feel like there's no point to moving forward, that there's a struggle that we just cannot overcome. We can't see the light at the end of the tunnel, and we don't know what God is doing. And that's a dark and depressing place to be in. But when we remember the hope that God has called you to, that God has not called you to sit in darkness and in despair and without knowing how to get out of your present troubles, even if you're in suffering and even if you're in a season of trial, God has called you to hope. He's called you to an inheritance that is unfading, undefiled, kept in heaven for you, and you will see Jesus face to face, and you will be with him, and he will wipe away every tear from your eye. Amen. That is our hope, and we need to cling to it. Pray, God, help me. Help me to know hope and to hold it close. God, let me pray for others that they may have hope, that they may know the hope that you have called them to, and that you would get them through their struggles because you walk with them and you give them hope. You see, just like Christian in prison, we do not have the ability in and of ourselves to cling to hope. It's only after, I find, that Christian and hopeful pray all night that Christian remembers, oh yeah, I've got this key in my pocket. I should probably pull it out. Prayer is important. We need to pray that God would remind us of the hope that he's given us, that God would remind others of the hope that God has given them, because without God's working, we can have no knowledge and no hope. So we must pray for his working. Well, knowledge and hope are important, and by all means, we should pray for those things, but knowledge and hope, again, in and of themselves, are lacking. Paul also prays for their knowledge of God's power at work within them. And God's power is the reason why we have knowledge and hope. Again, verse 18, having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, that you may know what? That you may know the hope he has called you to, that you may know what are the riches of his glorious inheritance, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power at work toward us who believe. And in this hope of God's power, specifically, he goes on to give us reasons and examples of how God's power has worked and reasons why God's power is necessary for us. God has worked in immeasurable greatness of his power toward us who believe, according, the second half of verse 19, according to the working of his great might that he worked in Christ. Well, what was the great might that he worked in Christ? Well, he's about to tell us. The great might that he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead. God raised Jesus from the dead by his great power. When he seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also into the one to come. God has a power that is above and beyond every power of this world, every power of Satan, the powers of the prince of the power of the air, the struggles that we face. God is more powerful, and he's able to lift Jesus from the dead, to bring him to life, and to exalt him and seat him in the heavenly places above every name and every power and every dominion. All authority, Jesus says, has been given to me in heaven and on earth. And the reason why that is encouraging for us is because we know that God works toward us with the same power that he has worked toward Christ. Paul, later and elsewhere in his epistles, will say, if God is able to raise Christ from the dead, how much more so is he able to raise you from the dead? If you have been buried with Christ, much more so will you be raised with him. Our salvation, our death to sin, and our life in Christ is guaranteed to us with the same power that God has worked in Jesus. Jesus, seated in heaven, risen from the dead, given a risen new body, is the promise that you will also be risen from the dead, that you also have hope for resurrection and eternal life, that you also will be seated in heaven with a new body before the Lord. Jesus is the demonstration of God's power that God will work to us. More than just his death and his resurrection, God shows his power. Thirdly, in verse 22, he raised Jesus, he seated Jesus, he put all things under his feet, And fourthly, he gave him as head over all things to the church. The fact that Jesus is given authority and power over all things is amazing. And that power is also at power at work in us. And not the same way that everything has been subjected to Jesus' feet. I'm not saying that everything has been subjected to your feet. But in the same way, Jesus has won victory over sin and death.
Amen.
And so too do you have the ability to have victory over sin and death. The struggles that you face, the sin that would lay you down, is something that we are able to put under our feet, not by our power, but by the power of Jesus at work within us. And Jesus has given himself to us as the head, that as a church, we may have a body together, we may have unity together, because there is one Savior and one Shepherd that leads us. It's not me that is the true pastor of this church. Jesus is your shepherd. Jesus is our head. And because Jesus is our head, we have great power at work within us. When we set foot to do the work of God as Butteville Community Church, in Butteville, in Donald, in Hubbard, in our regions, as we seek out the community around us to love them and to serve them and to bring them from death to life, we know that we can do that not by our strength, but by God's strength at work within us. Because as we go, Jesus goes with us. He is our head. And as the result, he is the culmination, the point, the purpose, to the praise of his glory, why we do everything we do as a church. What we do as a church is not in vain, because Jesus is our head. Through these four things that Paul gives as examples of the working of God's power, we have hope and we know that God is at work within us. But what's interesting, again, is that Paul knows this. Paul has hope that God is doing this, but Paul still prays that God would do this. He prays that God would do this in the lives of the Ephesians believers. And he gives us an example of how we are to pray. We also must pray that God would work his power in and through us. Because without his power at work within us, we can't do this. None of us has the power to bring someone from the dead to life. None of us has the power to seat someone in the heavenly places. No matter how much you strive and cry out after someone, no matter how much you plead and go over the gospel with a friend, a family member, a loved one, they cannot come to Christ unless God moves. And so we must work, but we pray that God would give knowledge, that he would give hope, and that by his power, he would be at work within us. I'm sorry to use so many illustrations about my children, but I have children, right? Remember with me back to a time when you had children in the house, and they're young, and they're learning, and they're growing, and they're trying to do things on their own. Sometimes I find that my children get frustrated, whether it's trying to tie their shoe or trying to open the door that is locked, or trying to open a window curtain that's stuck on something up high. They try and they pull, and what happens when they get frustrated? They scream and they whine and, why isn't this happening? And I sit there and I interact with them in conversation. And I say to them, hey, what would you like to do right now? Would you like to pull at your shoelaces and scream and scream and scream and pull and pull and pull and have nothing happen? What do you do when you're frustrated and powerless? You come ask Daddy for help. And I come and I crouch down in love with them. And whatever the problem is, it takes me seconds, right? They pull and they scream and they can't do it. And I just pop, boom, there it's done. You asked for Daddy's help. And look how easy that was, right? Sometimes we can go about trying to do the Christian life in our own strength. And we wonder why we get frustrated when things aren't going the way we want them to go. We ought to pray that our Heavenly Father gives us his power, because his power far surpasses ours. His power is great. He brings the dead to life. He seats them in the heavenly places. And as we'll see next week, he does so for us. But God, being rich in mercy because of the great love that he had for us, made you alive and seated you in the heavenly places with Christ. We must pray for that. It's not enough simply to know that that's what God does. We may be good theologians and know that God does that work. Paul prays that God would do that work for the Ephesians, and we should pray also. We must pray for God's power at work within us. And I'll give a shameless plug. Come to Wednesday night prayer. There's many good things that God is doing in this church and that God will do. But God is not going to do great things in this church simply because you have a young pastor with new energy. He's not going to do new things in this church because we have new this or new that. He's going to do work in this church as he works and as we pray. Amen? Our prayer for God's working is essential to the ministry that God has given to us. We want the lost to be saved. We want believers to be built up into maturity. We want God to bring the dead to life, seating them in the heavenly places, subjecting everything under his feet. You may ask, why aren't we seeing these things? I think the better question is, why aren't we praying for it? I'd encourage you, reach up your hand and take hold of the shopping cart and push with your Father. See the things that he will do through his power, through you. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word and we thank you for the encouragement and the challenge that it gives. We pray that you would make us people of prayer, that it would not be enough for us simply to know what the Bible says and to have knowledge that you are working and that you will save people through other people and that we can just sit at home and do nothing. We pray that you would challenge us to movement, to action, and that our first and foremost actions would be that of prayer. Coming before you on our knees with thanksgiving for the work that you're doing, asking you to give us knowledge and hope and power to do the work that you are doing. And we pray that you would encourage us, that you would help us to persist in prayer, and that you would show us that everything is subjected to your feet, that you are working, that you give us ways to work and to push the cart with you, that you are the fullness, and that you fill everything. You fill us all in all. Help us to work alongside you and bless us as we do. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
I encourage you to stand. This song talks about that power that Pastor Jacob was talking about in Ephesians. It says there's power in the blood. 2, 3, 4. How would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you a victory win? There is wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power. Sing this verse, I'll start you. 1, 2, ready, and power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
Would you do service for Jesus, your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you do daily His praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power,
wonder-working power. Power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
Amen. Thank you, Roger and worship team, for leading us. I would encourage you, I would implore you, if you have not tasted of this power in your life, if you doubt if God has made you from death to life, come talk to me, come talk to the elders. We'd love to see you come to this knowledge of who God is. I'd also encourage you, come hang out with us after the service. Eat some snacks, hang out, fellowship with the believers. And as we go, hear the word of the Lord. You can say it with me if you want. Now to Him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to Him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Lord bless you this week.